Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year. It's RKO 1946. We'll be discussing Step by Step and Crack Up. Before we get into any of that, let's dip into Jewell W. Finler's The Hollywood Story. He's got his fabled pink and gray chart where he presents all of the important, in his mind, players on contract to each studio during a particular calendar year. He gives them 1, 2, or 3 star ratings. Sometimes we understand why, other times we are left scratching our heads. Johnny Weissmuller, 1 star. This is the downgraded Tarzan serial once it left MGM. Pat O'Brien, 2 stars, relevant to our episode this week. John Wayne, 2 stars. Robert Ryan, 3 stars. Barbara Hale, 1 star. Jane Greer, 2 stars. Loretta Young, 3 stars. George Raft, 2 stars. Robert Mitchum, 3 stars. Cary Grant, 3 stars. Lorraine Day, 2 stars. Tim Holt, 1 star. And that'll do it.
No mentions of Lawrence Tierney?
Nope.
Or Claire Trevor?
No, and I think Lawrence Tierney probably was under contract to them. I don't know about Claire Trevor. She worked a little bit all over the place, but she does seem to have done a lot of RKO movies in the mid-40s. We've got the RKO story to reckon with. This is written by Richard B. Jewell and Vernon Harbin. And this is one of the few of the studio coffee table books that gives a year in review roundup for the studio itself. So let's hear what they had to say about RKO's fate in first year after the war. RKO's mightiest year generated a record-shattering $12,187,804 in net profits, $72,966,727 gross film rentals, and such well-remembered releases as Notorious, The Spiral Staircase, The Best Years of Our Lives, and It's a Wonderful Life. Now, several of those were just distributed by RKO, so they don't really count the way we reckon things. Regrettably, the man most responsible for this bounty did not live to receive the plaudits he so richly deserved. Studio chief Charles Kerner contracted leukemia in late 1945 and died on February 2nd. To minimize the turmoil caused by Kerner's death, corporate president N. Peter Rathvon took over production, while a survey was conducted to find a qualified successor to the most successful executive producer in company annals.
I have never heard of this guy.
Well, he's the guy that sort of stepped in after all the chaos of the Orson Welles years.
So, a banker type?
And that's my sense. I don't know much about him. The only other important management change was the mid-year departure of executive assistant William Dozier, who left to enter independent production. Two of Rathvon's biggest headaches were continued labor unrest, which caused some production slowdowns, and a concomitant rise in filmmaking costs. B pictures were now almost twice as expensive as they had been before the war, and some of the A films were nosing up to and beyond the $2 million mark. Still, with business so prosperous, there seemed no reason for alarm. One group of films was phased out, the horror pictures. Along with them went producer Val Lewton, who had provided the most interesting cluster of programmers in RKO history. With the company enjoying an unprecedented number of commitments from named stars, Rathvon began concentrating on the development of young actors into box office names. Barbara Bel Geddes was signed during the year, and Robert Mitchum, Bill Williams, Barbara Hale, Jane Greer, Lawrence Tierney, Anne Jeffries, and other hopefuls.
Well, he acknowledges Lawrence Tierney.
And Anne Jeffries. They received exceptional opportunities to demonstrate their talent.
Exceptional.
Of the 34 releases, RKO made its heftiest profits from Notorious, The Spiral Staircase, Bad Man's Territory, Till the End of Time, and Cornered. All right, now let's hear their review of Step by Step. This was a B-level chase film that ground to a halt long before its seemingly interminable 62 minutes elapsed.
Wow.
Anne Jeffries and Lawrence Tierney zoom up and down the California countryside, pursued by Nazis determined to rebuild their country's lost pride, and similarly determined to relieve Tierney of certain incriminating papers which have innocently fallen into his possession. The unfortunate couple are also hunted by the police, who believe that naive Mr. Tierney has murdered a federal agent. All in all, it was a shameful waste of petroleum and celluloid. Stuart Palmer wrote the unfocused screenplay.
So this was not one of the miraculous opportunities for these actors of which you spoke.
Clearly not. It was based on a story by George Callahan, and Phil Rosen provided the consistent misdirection.
Whoa.
Lowell Gilmore, George Cleveland, Jason Robards, Myrna Dell, Harry Harvey, Addison Richards, Ray Walker, and John Hamilton also participated for executive producer Sid Rogel. So did you find it interminable?
I quickly tuned out of the plot, which was not remarkable.
No.
There wasn't really anything in the way of atmosphere either. What was left was Lawrence Tierney getting to play a type of role that he didn't usually get to play. A nice guy.
Sort of average guy, yeah.
A nice and average guy, although he can punch with the best of them.
Well, he's a Marine.
There you go. Average Marine. He's quite fun and charming.
Yeah, he was not bad, and I liked Anne Jeffries a lot.
She didn't get as much to do, but she was pleasant. She later went on to be a soap opera queen.
I think it starts out quite well.
Well, other than the fact that you have to swallow that this woman, the secretary, has managed to get this ultra top secret job without any references.
She's a sharp operator. She did work for the senator's friend, so she's trying to take advantage of this old boys network.
But apparently, we don't really know, but she somehow managed to convince the senator that she knew this man, despite the fact that she only worked for him for 4 days, so that he didn't even feel a requirement to check her references for a top secret security. This is ridiculous.
Well, the senator may have been looking at her other attributes.
Well, then he's utterly failed in his role.
I agree. Well, don't most senators?
Yes, but he hasn't. I knew you were going to try to spin this as it being realistic. It's just bad. It's just really bad, bad plotting. You could come up with some other reason for her to be viewed as untrustworthy.
I don't know. I found it kind of fun. It did get you wondering right away. Like, oh, what's going on here? She seems like a nice woman, but she's lying to her boss. Is she an evil spy? A servant of Nazism? Maybe.
Yeah, but we're not supposed to be mystified about that.
Well, we are, because she's acting weird in the car in
the first
scene.
Yeah, but we're not mystified by it at the point at which everyone else thinks she's that.
Well, that's true. But it could have been. I was thinking, you know, is there going to be some kind of switcheroo at the end where it turns out that she really was
a Nazi? I was never thinking that. I just thought this was bad writing. The way this meet cute at the beach is described on Wikipedia is, and I don't know if this is deliberate or just a happy accident of bad sentence structure, it says that he and his war dog, that being Johnny, Lawrence Tierney's character, he and his war dog, Bazooka, flirt with Evelyn, who smiles and then returns to Remy's home. Or does he think the dog is in fact flirting with her?
I think that's exactly what's happening. And she's more impressed with the dog, as was I. I mean, that dog was awesome. My sense was that this was the progeny of Terry, who played Toto. There's not enough written about the great dog actors. The dog was probably my favorite part of the movie.
Well, I assumed that that would be the case, but isn't that always the case when an animal appears in a movie?
Sometimes there's more competition. The movie is definitely asking audiences to revel in the mostly nude body of Lawrence Tierney for a long time.
And you know, not bad, not bad. I don't know how he was such an alcoholic wreck while keeping this figure.
Well, he looks like a typical barrel-chested He-Man of the time, yeah.
Yeah, he stays shirtless for longer than she stays uncovered in her bathing suit.
Yeah, well, she goes to the beach. We definitely get a good look at her, and so does Lawrence Tierney. That's what causes him to park his car.
But I guess that they thought that the audience for this movie was women and gay men. He's certainly not a romantic lead, but they are treating him as though he's supposed to be an attraction for women.
So he takes his shot at seducing Anne Jeffries. It doesn't work out. She heads back to the house. He watches her go longingly. Moments later, we see her get knocked out. Now, there's been a spy plot going on before this.
I also loved the writing, which you could attribute to the perfunctory nature of the spy's plot. plans, in this case, that they've made a portrait just in case they get caught for the few moments they're going to be in this house to verify that this is the real senator. And they even lampshaded by the guy saying to the other guy, that portrait was a great idea.
Yeah.
But they're not even planning for anyone to see them, correct? So this has all been done just in case.
Just in case. They're very cautious. At this point, anyway. But later, they become more reckless and pretty stupid. Everyone is a little bit...
I mean, it's really prudent to bring a portrait. But then that's the end. They think they're done then. They've done their job.
I really like it's a phone call very early on between the agent who has collected the names of the servants of fascism in America and the senator. And he's just about to start listing them. And then he looks out the window and there's this glaringly obvious microphone just lurking outside
his
window.
Yeah, but we actually saw something very similar with a counterfeit traitor. That's how he becomes aware that he's being spied on after his girlfriend, Lily Palmer, was captured. He sees...
Yeah, this was more obvious than that. That was a microphone that looked quite a bit like a light bulb. You had to be looking really carefully. This was just something hovering outside the window.
He wasn't looking carefully, though. He was just staring at the ceiling, as a person would do in a hotel room, and happened to... notice. I mean, I guess you'd have to be a little paranoid, but they would expect him to be paranoid.
I maintain that this was a more egregious...
No, I mean, the writers don't have a whole lot of ingenuity. And the spies, the only ingenuity they exhibited was that portrait, and they patted themselves on the back for it.
Sure, they did. I really like, too, how Lawrence Tierney is just offended by the replacement Miss Smith, the spy's foist upon the world.
Keeps commenting on how he wants to see the pretty one.
Yeah, this is the ugly blonde.
Well, she's a Nazi.
Now, there was an inside person on the job. It turns out it's the shifty chauffeur. And we got a hint of that because he wasn't really tied up properly when Lawrence Tierney was breaking into the house. All kinds of shenanigans occur, and he's got no clothes on for so long that he desperately grabs whatever he can find. He gets some pants first, and then he gets that leather jacket that turns out to be much sought after by the spies because it actually has the list in it. Half the movie, well, they're either racing around crazily or they're hanging out at this fishing camp, motor court, that is run by a genial old man who, because he was also in the Marines, believes Lawrence Tierney is innocent.
He does help uncover the mystery to the cops.
He and the dog, yeah. And he actually, I mean, he goes way above and beyond what most helpful oldsters do in movies like this. I mean, he drives the getaway car.
Yeah, they become a little comedy team.
He's really willing to put his life on the line for this young couple.
Probably the cleverest bit of writing and direction in the whole movie was when the Nazis throw a hammer at the dog. God. And then the dog shows up with the hammer in his mouth just in time for Lawrence Tierney to need to break into his car.
He's like, yeah, thanks, bazooka.
So, no, really, the rapport between Lawrence Tierney and the dog was pretty great.
It was. Lawrence Tierney can't have been that much of a creep.
Look, he was a violent alcoholic. I don't know if that makes you a creep or not. It makes you very hard to get along with.
The dogs liked him, clearly. A couple fun little jokes in the movie. You know, when they're going to spend their first night together at the motor court, Lawrence Tierney makes an allusion to it happened one night. Do I have to put up the sheet to separate us in the room? And she's like, no, I'll separate us. And she just takes the whole bedroom for herself.
Tells her that the wardrobe was an insult.
Yeah, she locks the door. He's like, that's fine, but come on, putting furniture in front of the door too, like, makes me look bad.
They have pretty fun chemistry. I really feel like he could do B romantic comedies. This could have been a whole different career for him.
It could have been. Don't know how well this one did.
Well, it's a shit movie.
I've enjoyed watching it, but I did think...
It is not remarkable.
It didn't justify its length of 62 minutes. And it ends with a crazy domestic violence joke. They finally make it to the altar, and he's just been in a fist fight with several Nazis.
She does help out a bit.
She does, yeah. But she doesn't get scuffed up. He does. He's got a black eye, and everyone remarks...
Did you want her to be beaten up and torn up?
No, but... that's what makes the joke, I guess, at the end, that she looks all pristine and ready to get married, and he looks like hell. And they're like, well, you must have really had to force him into this. And that's step by step.
Oh, there were moments with the Nazis running around with this shittily written plot where it had the real feel of a Scooby-Doo type mystery. You could have amped it up and put some real comedians in it, and then you might have had a box office smash.
I don't know.
Well, you would have needed some actual jokes, too.
When they're giving descriptions to the police, I never heard any of this come out. I don't know how Lawrence Tierney knows it. He says the head spy is a German who is affecting a British accent. I mean, because he's played by a British actor. Nobody ever told him that. That actor was in Johnny Angel. He plays the gangster that was sort of manipulating things behind the scene from his club. Now, who played the old man? George Cleveland, Captain Caleb Simpson. He was, oh look, you got a picture of him with Lassie, so he liked working with dogs too, clearly.
He was Canadian from Nova Scotia.
Yeah, he kind of had a down east accent, didn't he? Well, he references New England.
He made many and many and many a movie.
My favorite line of his was when Lawrence Tierney, because they're trying to keep incognito, they don't want the news reports getting out, he's disabled the old man's radio, and he's several steps ahead of them all the time. He tells them he trusts them, he's going to help them. Now, can he please have his radio part back so that he can listen to Dick Tracy at 9 o'clock?
I kind of liked their facing death scene where they're up against it with the Nazis.
No, that was good.
And Jeffries is telling him, I don't want you to think I'm chicken-hearted, but this is the end, isn't it?
Yeah, she's like, we're not gonna make it out of this. Yeah, that was really good, actually. Like, it felt like a different movie all of a sudden, with more conviction behind it.
Here's the thing, the actors are very good. The main actors are very good.
They were not helped by the script.
They were not helped by the script, but they did, like I said, they had a fun chemistry, and I enjoyed watching their relationship. And also his relationship with the dog. And that's what we can say for this movie. If you feel like that, I mean, if you're listening to this podcast, you possibly have already watched the movie. You've got to understand that we're trying to get through everything we can find from these studios. Eventually, if we live long enough, we will watch everything. So we've been pretty lucky with the quality, but it's not always going to be there.
This was just a random pick. There are obviously better movies made by RKO in 1946, and one of those is Crack Up. So the RKO story has this to say about our second film. Crack Up opened with Pat O'Brien's fist smashing through the door of a museum and never slowed its action-packed pace until the end credits crawled across the screen. Still, action was not enough as far as movie customers were concerned. They never could make much sense of the contrived and disjointed plot, and left the film swaying pitifully in the box office breeze, unappreciated and unattended. Writers John Paxton, Ben Bengel, and Ray Spencer worked on Frederick Brown's story Madman's Holiday, which had something to do with the forgery and theft of priceless paintings by a group of international crooks. Pat O'Brien is an art expert and lecturer who treads upon the villain's carefully laid plans and pays for his clumsiness by suffering what appears to be a violent mental breakdown. Also in the cast, Claire Trevor as O'Brien's supportive fiancé, Herbert Marshall as a Scotland Yard man posing as a visiting art expert, Wallace Ford as a hard-nosed police detective, Erskine Sanford as the head of the museum, along with Ray Collins, Dean Herons, Damien O'Flynn, and Mary Ware. Irving Reis, making his first film after being discharged from the army, displayed real directorial flair in several brilliantly executed scenes, but he clearly didn't give much thought to the logic of his narrative. Jack J. Gross was the executive producer.
Okay, first of all, is she his fiance?
I don't think they ever say that exactly, but
she's going on, apparently, dates with other men.
They have a long-standing relationship that has cooled, or it's been damaged by the fact that he's been away for 3 years.
Yes,
in the war.
This is why I say I don't think she's his fiance.
She may have been at one point, and maybe they never officially broke it off, but they're in a kind of holding pattern. That's my sense. Maybe she's his fiance in the story.
You think the summary read the story?
I don't know. The story is hard to find. We watched the Eddie Muller Noir Alley introduction, and he mentioned that it'll cost you over $500 to get a hold of this story. And I looked online and that's still correct. It doesn't seem to have been reprinted in any more easily accessible manner.
The next thing to ask about the summary. Now, I found the plot a bit hard to follow, but that's not uncommon. I'm not a plot follower. I don't watch movies in order to follow plots. I'm not interested in doing that. I do not try to second guess what's happening in a mystery. I don't try to figure it out. That's why Hitchcock works so well for me, because he spells everything out with absolute clarity. But did this actually have plot holes? Because I thought it made sense.
No, I don't think so. I think it's presented in a very unusual manner, and that's by design.
But at the end, the villain has his Bond villain speech, and he's like, I wanted to possess these paintings, and nothing could stop me from, have you ever wanted something? At that point, we're pretty well assured that he's been replacing these paintings with forgeries so that he can own the actual paintings.
Yeah.
And that's the whole fucking plot. What is so hard to understand?
And we're also shown exactly how Pat O'Brien came to the misconception that he was in a horrifying train wreck. He was subjected to kind of Manchurian candidate drug and hypnosis.
Presumably the reason they tried to discredit him.
He was going to turn an x-ray on the painting. Yeah, you have to wait till the end to find out, but
that's normal in a mystery.
I've always loved this movie. I saw it when I was pretty young and I had it taped off TV. I watched it quite a lot. It really does a good job of putting you in a disoriented state from the beginning. And those scenes with Pat O'Brien on the train, I mean, they feel like the Twilight Zone.
Well, let's not get there yet. It's getting ahead of ourselves. But I'll start by saying that it's an unusual role for Pat O'Brien based on his star persona.
A swaggering art critic.
He's swaggering, but, you know, just as he usually is on film, but to very different effect in a film noir. He's smug, but at the same time, I don't think I've ever seen a noir hero this vulnerable throughout the entire movie.
Yeah, well, he is half convinced that he's gone insane.
Yeah, and he does manage to get the forged painting. But other than that, he never gets the better of the bad guys. What is the expression? I don't understand pool, but he's behind the eight ball the whole time?
Yeah, he's in the dark corner. This is our second straight Hollywood Studios year by year with a film noir set in the art world.
True, and I said that was probably the most vulnerable loser of a noir hero that I'd ever seen, but this even more so. It feels like in the B movies, they're willing to go, well, I mean, many noirs were B movies, but many weren't. And in the B movies, they're really willing to go even further with that aspect of the noir protagonist.
Yeah, and as you get a sense gradually through the film, and certainly by the end, you understand that the only person that really knew what was going on was Herbert Marshall. And he makes no bones about it. He has been using Pat O'Brien as a decoy and possibly expendable cat's paw.
Yeah, just in order to get this Gainsborough back to England.
Very important.
But Claire Trevor knew more of what was going on than he did.
Yeah, but not the whole truth. She knows enough to know that Herbert Marshall sees the big picture and is concealing some things from her. She's the intermediary. She's sort of like the sanity connector between Pat O'Brien and the real world as represented by Herbert Marshall. But she doesn't think of Pat O'Brien as expendable the way Herbert Marshall does. So she's in a tough spot, and she gives a great performance in this movie, I think. She's just as backed into a corner in many ways as Pat O'Brien is, because she's right there with him and she loves him. I mean, they're a weird couple, but I actually really like their scene in the bar.
They're a very weird couple.
Pat O'Brien.
Yeah, who's really just a schlubby middle-aged man.
But he's got that art critic flair. He knows how to put down a surrealist.
So as you said, the movie opens with a bang.
It does. I mean, Pat O'Brien is really off the chain.
He's Lawrence Tierney on a bender. That's what people think he is, actually.
He's just smashing away at the front door of the museum, breaks a window, a cop tries to intervene, and he assaults the cop. They both stumble into the museum, and they knock over a giant marble statue that gets shattered, almost falls on them and kills them. And it's nighttime at the museum here, but there's a meeting in session chaired by Erskine Sanford, the director. They all come down and the cop is like, whoever this guy is, he's been on one hell of a bender.
Pat O'Brien is already in the bad books of the museum's board.
Yeah, we don't know why at this point. They still don't want bad publicity. publicity. Erskine Sanford makes that very clear. He whispers in the cop's ear, could you please just not make a big deal about this? Call one of your superiors and find out if we can hush this up. Eventually, we have a scene behind closed doors with Wallace Ford, the lieutenant, who asks some more pointed questions and insults Pat O'Brien. I love Wallace Ford. He's always great. Very unsympathetic to Pat O'Brien, and yet we know he's going to let him off.
Now, because we know the genre and we know that there's going to have to be a mystery here, we are already on Pat O'Brien's side. We know that whatever is going on, it's not that he's either drunk or crazy.
Right, but what could he possibly have been doing? Like, what could his plan have been?
So all of this feels very persecutory.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like, you know, did we hallucinate that? Like, why was he doing that? And actually, there is no reason. He actually was a madman coming down off of sodium pentothal or whatever it was that Ray Collins gave him.
Yeah, I don't think the truth serum alone, or did he say it was truth serum plus
hypnotic effect? Right. Yeah, I mean, it fucked him up completely.
Well, yeah, he's in a panic because he thinks that he has just been in or is in a train wreck.
Yeah, and that's all he knows, and he knows there's something weird going on at the museum, and that's why he needed to try to smash the windows in. But I mean, he wasn't going to achieve anything by doing that. So he was actually crazy and ineffectual at that point, and through most of the movie.
Yes, but we know there's some reason behind this beyond him just having a nervous breakdown.
Yeah, and so all of the officials and the board members gather around. Ray Collins is the respectable doctor. He looks him over. Of course, you know, we know by the end of the movie, Ray Collins is the man that turned him into this gibbering idiot.
So there's all these Mercury Theater players in various roles. Presumably they are at RKO. I don't know if they'd be under contract or if they would just be getting plugged into these roles because the studio is familiar with them.
It's basically a setup for a flashback. As they try to talk Pat O'Brien down, they ask him, you know, well, what led up to all of this? Why do you think you were in a train wreck? What happened to you today? We go back in time, and here we see a much more put together Pat O'Brien speaking to a large crowd.
But here's the thing, we've seen him...
I mean, he looks really bad in those first scenes.
Yeah, we've seen him look like and act like a complete mess. Yeah, and he looks terrible. He looks on death's door when they're sort of interrogating him afterwards. And yeah, the cop is being, under Herbert Marshall's direction, the cop is being abusive, bullying. He's on the outs with the head of the museum, director of the museum. So it's important, I think, that we have to feel his helplessness and vulnerability continuously. And then it's compounded by this weird relationship with Claire Trevor, where he's also very vulnerable and he's jealous that she seems to be spending so much time with other men.
Yeah, the art critic Reynolds, who seems like he might have a sinister plan of his own, but doesn't. Except to be a sneering art critic.
And I think we have to feel how helpless and beleaguered he is leading up to this first train ride in order to get the effect of it.
Yeah, and it does an amazing job of that, I think. So we see him, again, the only place where he feels like he's in control is when he's in front of an audience of the broad public talking about art and pontificating about the superiority of
realism,
the classics, over, you know, contemporary modernist efforts that are creeping into the museum. He unveils a surrealist painting and makes fun of it. The audience is on his side there, except for one guy who's got a Hitler mustache who starts barking at him about his philistinism. His approach to modern art kind of echoes Gary Cooper's attitudes in Mr. Deeds, right? Where he goes around punching all of the sneering Algonquin round table people.
Of course, as Eddie Muller pointed out in that Noir Alley introduction, the irony is that the movie does not have a classical or realist approach to representation.
Yeah, and RKO was doing all kinds of weird fractured narratives in the mid-40s with their noirs. So yeah, they're more on the modernist edge of things as films go, but not Pat O'Brien himself.
Surrealism is supposedly excavating the unconscious, and that's also what the expressionism of film noir is attempting to do.
Yeah, I'm surprised that they decided to pick on surrealism. I mean, abstract art, I could see. The film is not necessarily endorsing his attitudes, although...
Well, okay, well, what he is actually saying, because he gets into it with the museum director, is that this is a public institution and you're running it like it's for just the donors who are, you know, keeping it afloat. But it's supposed to be for the public.
Yeah, I mean, you can see both sides of the argument. Just like when we talked about Mr. Deeds. I mean, Gary Cooper's character has a point. The opera should not be run in such a way that only certain people can appreciate it. However, there has to be some attention paid to the avant-garde and to innovation in art. We're not entirely going to cater to what's already accepted as canon. I mean, the canon has to grow, has to expand. And so, I mean, I think there's room for both opinions there. But yeah, the movie stacks the deck by making us think about it in class terms.
That said, there could be, you could see a deliberate irony in the fact that Pat O'Brien's sort of blowing the trumpet for rationality even as he's going to pieces.
All of this happens before he goes to pieces. In a way, this movie is about World War II, just like Cornered was, right? It happens after the war, but you've got a traumatized war vet. I mean, that's what Pat O'Brien is. He was involved in numerous operations as an art expert, but going into the European theater of war, trying to help out with excavating and rescuing art treasures from the Nazis. And he must have seen all kinds of awful things. He's been away for 3 years. His relationship with Claire Trevor has gotten off track. And he talks at length about how he and everyone that went through this, their greatest fear was cracking up. And now the pressure is on and he is starting to crack up. John Paxton also wrote Cornered. So you've got that threat.
Cinematographer, very important here, Robert DeGrasse. Just one of those, like most of them, cinematographers who just adapted his style to the decade and to the film type. The other noir I see in his filmography here is Born to Kill. It does have some great imagery in it.
He shot Miracle of the Bells. That's a movie I love that I think a lot of people just think is terrible. Sentimental Ben Hecht romance that is shot like a noir. It's very cool.
Okay.
I think.
As we say so often with film noir, the style, even though no one was aware of making a style of movie called film noir or that there was a genre they were working within, turned ordinary cinematographers into geniuses. So we get this weird date with Claire Trevor.
Yeah, I really like it. They don't have long to rebuild their rapport and make you sense what was there before the war. I don't know, I believed it. It felt good watching them there. And then he gets a phone call. He's just about talked her into breaking her date with Herbert Marshall. They're remembering the good times. He's called away.
Well, I like the fact that the date scene is so leisurely. The movie's giving time despite needing to keep up the pace of the crime drama to giving some weight to this relationship. She is going to be kind of his emotional anchor in all of this, even though he becomes suspicious of her as well. But she's persistent, as we saw Lucille Ball being in the dark corner.
I mean, she really is all that holds him together at certain points in this film. Yeah, the movie does a good job of keeping you off kilter there too, because you know that something's going on with her and Herbert Marshall. You can't be 100% sure that you're not going to get a reveal that Herbert Marshall is actually some kind of evil double agent or something that's been setting him up, and she's either in on it or an unwitting tool.
The way she's playing it, I don't believe that.
Well, her concern for Pat O'Brien is genuine, yeah. That's clear, but what else is she up to, if anything?
Yeah, I don't believe she's deliberately doing anything to hurt him, but when he questions her alliance with Herbert Marshall later on, that scene is very good in the arcade at generating paranoia.
Oh, yeah.
Right? When Herbert Marshall just shows up and he's thick as thieves with Claire Trevor, even though everything you've seen leads you to believe that Claire Trevor wouldn't betray Pat O'Brien, nevertheless, in that moment, you can experience his paranoia.
Yeah, and everyone's operating at cross purposes there, too, because she's summoned Herbert Marshall because she thinks they can talk Pat O'Brien into turning himself into the police. Herbert Marshall doesn't want him to turn himself into the police, so he talks about him doing that because it's the sensible thing and that's what Claire Trevor's expecting him to do. But in fact, he leaves himself open to getting, you know, headbutted by Pat O'Brien. I mean, Herbert Marshall's almost as much in control of this movie as he was when he was the novelist on The Razor's Edge. Clearly is expecting something like that to happen. He's willing to sacrifice a few bruises to getting Pat O'Brien back out there running around, drawing the criminals out into clear view.
So these are two movies, both Step by Step and Crack Up, that have North by Northwest-like elements in them.
The Dark Corner had similar aspects to it, right? Again, he's not the primary victim. He is a middleman in a much larger game that he doesn't understand.
So back to the date scene, as you said, it ends with Pat O'Brien getting a phone call about his mother being ill and he has to rush off and take this train.
All the other pressures he's been under, he's trying to get his career back on track. He's giving these lectures at the museum that are going well. The public is responding well to them, but the powers that be at the museum don't like it. He's trying to pass that off as no big deal. He's going to win ultimately. He does have his one ally. Stevenson, I think, is the character's name, who's the curator. But the really powerful people are getting more and more annoyed with his behavior. And now he's found out that his mother is dying. He has to hop on a train. And yeah, here we really enter the Twilight Zone.
Yeah, I agree. It felt, both of the train sequences felt like a good Twilight Zone episode, which isn't true that often of film noir.
No, this was beautiful stuff. I loved it when I first saw it. I always remembered it. I would rewatch it just to see those scenes sometimes.
Yeah, it gave me a nightmare. First of all, leading up to it, we get some details that prove to be important later. We get the man helping the drunk man onto the train. We get the not important detail of the comic detail of the wife lecturing her husband that this is going to be him soon.
That's gonna be you if you don't stop hitting that bottle.
Jabbing her finger in his face. And then we get the comical vendor.
Have I been discoursing to no purpose?
To no avail.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah.
With his borscht belt patter.
Great.
You want I should remember you?
Well, that's the second.
That's the second ride. And he's just so irate. Like, he's just another element going off in Pat O'Brien's face, right? Everyone, it's the whole world is just too rough and harsh for him.
And it's such an existentialist nightmare, the whole thing, right? Like, especially the second ride, because he goes on the train hoping to meet someone who will remember him. And it's all the same people, and none of them remarked upon his passing whatsoever.
Well, that's that's familiar enough from noirs and mysteries. Often you have to find the man who saw you so that you have an alibi. That's in Double Indemnity, right?
Yeah, but often those people are keeping their mouths shut for some sinister reason. Here, these people genuinely don't have any idea who he is. They didn't notice him at all, even if they talked to him yesterday.
Right, and again, like I said, the movie here and now, we're talking about the second ride, but the absolute helplessness of schlubby, passive, slow Pat O'Brien, trying even just to talk to the ticket takers to see if they remember him, and like little old ladies telling him to fuck off.
I'm trying to get to see my daughter in Utica. Get out of the way.
He's absolutely helpless. But yeah, okay, to get to the actual sequences. So then you get a lot of it is identical the second time. Shot from outside of his face in the window with the steam rising up.
It's like William Shatner in Nightmare at 20,000 Feet. Yeah, so its own episode.
Yeah, what is this perspective?
Yeah.
Some kind of monstrous perspective. Then the sound. I mean, the sound is very important. This rhythmic sound that ends up being a frightening pattern, right? That also sounds like a monster pursuing him. As this other train, like the external shots of the blackness outside the window themselves, like just utter blackness, right? Contribute to this sense of terrifying isolation, despite the fact that he's in a cabin full of people.
But he's all alone with those lights. Nobody else is noticing, nobody cares, and his eyes look, I mean, he does some great acting in those scenes. He looks so unbelievably scared.
Well, the cutting, right, as the sound increases, there's the cutting between the train coming toward them around that corner with, like I said, just utter blackness surrounding it, and cutting back and forth between the lights and his face is just absolutely terrified. A cartoon of terror.
Again, I think maybe this is reading too much into it, but this is all scheduled. These trains are supposed to be running exactly these routes, and it's to me, it feels like a visual commentary on just how close to the edge we are playing it every single day, just by taking our routine actions, you know, in the city or on our commute. Such a delicate system. It just seemed like it should fall apart and crack up. Usually it doesn't, but, and most people are completely blind to it. Sort of like Flitcroft in The Maltese Falcon, who has the beams fall right next to him. And this puts him out of whack with the universe. And Pat O'Brien, for whatever reason, happens to be in the exact right window seat to observe the abyss that is yawning beneath the sleek modern conveyances that facilitate life in 1946.
Right, because the interior of the train is so cozy.
Yeah.
Right? But it's this coziness that is on the edge of this abyss that only Pat O'Brien is gazing out at.
Yeah. And I mean, he's been nudged into a position of susceptibility by his war experiences and by the upsets in his relationship.
And his career. His
conflict with the director, everything. Yeah. And then it's only going to get worse as intrigue adds itself to the mix.
So the first train journey is...
Well, he's telling us in flashback, and for him it ends with the appearance of a deadly crash.
Yeah, the first train journey is frightening enough. But the second train journey, where he tries to figure out what happened during the first one, when everything repeats itself, like, as, because I'd never seen this before, as I was watching it for the first time, and every detail is repeating itself.
I mean, he has to facilitate some of that. He has to move a little guy out of his seat. That actor is great.
Oh, yeah, no, that was great. Because all of a sudden, he's the bully.
Yeah.
Right? It's like all of this subtle, every interaction is a bullying in this movie, right? And in this case, he's the bully. And the little nerd who could be out of the Twilight Zone episode about the man who wants to be left alone to read,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, like Burgess Meredith.
He's looking all around. He's like, there's all of these empty seats. And so he just thinks that he's being randomly bullied.
Yeah.
He's like the inner Pat O'Brien. But yeah, as everything was being repeated, exactly the same as he looks out the window. The first train ride had already felt Twilight Zone-ish, but this was like, at this point in the movie, I was asking myself, this is impossible. It is impossible that this is going to happen again. Like, at that point, you are in the Twilight Zone. If he's just in this train wreck that never happens, but always happens over and over again, right?
Yeah, like the death ship.
And yeah, I mean, my mind was just completely blown. The movie completely had me at that moment saying, this is impossible, this is impossible. What is happening? Yeah. And of course, he's asking himself that. Then the train wreck doesn't actually come, but there's this insane, this is the part that gave me the nightmare, I think, at the peak of his anxiety, or right after the peak when it's starting to subside, but sort of flares up right after the wreck doesn't happen, right after the train goes past. There's this image of his face goes tiny against a completely black backdrop.
Yeah.
Right? Just recedes into the distance and becomes tiny and then swings back up at us, growing to larger than normal size. Oh, yeah. What year is Detour?
45, I think.
Because another detail of this sequence is his watch that becomes this enormous expressionistic image hanging below his window in the train.
You don't know exactly what's going to happen there, right? Like, is he going to faint when the crash doesn't occur? I mean, what are we actually going to see? And no, he manages to keep it together better than that, but you're left in confusion by the visuals for a while. And then, because what happened the first time we learn is that he got chloroformed when the trains nearly collided and then was dragged off under the pretense of his being a drunken man. And so...
Right, and he absorbed all of these images into the hypnotic suggestion.
Yeah, exactly. When he doesn't get chloroformed this time, he remains conscious, and he knows that he must have been dragged off the train at this weird station in the middle of nowhere, Marlin. And we did at least get the assurance that his mother was not dying, so whoever made that call was lying. Right, he was diverted there. He was put on that train for the express purpose of being chloroformed and taken somewhere in Marlin. And so he gets off the train there, and fortunately, here's the one man that remembers him, but remembers him in such a strange way, and it has to be really teased out because This old guy is screaming about artists and free living. People coming home at 11 o'clock at night, drunk from New York. All that New York money that does it. This is an old man that liked the suburbs a lot more when they weren't so closely connected with the urban hell of New York.
Again, he could just be another manifestation of Pat O'Brien's anxiety.
He's like a really stylized weirdo. I mean, he's almost up in the Nightman territory from Touch of Evil as he complains about the deterioration of morals.
That's what I mean. About him being a manifestation of Pat O'Brien's anxiety, because that's sort of what Pat O'Brien's going on about, his hatred of modern life.
But Pat O'Brien is able to seize on the man's disdain, because the man naturally is averse to speaking to anyone, but he does like to complain, and he finally puts it together. Oh, wait, the reason he's going on like this is because I was the drunk man yesterday, and he's telling me off. He never gets a 100% acknowledgement of that, but it's good enough. The man is trying to close his counter, and Pat O'Brien is like holding it up a little bit. He's like, was it me? Was it me? Was I the drunk guy? And the guy's like, no business of mine what you want to do. My counter's closed. And there are some really trippy, maybe these are done because, I don't know, budget constraints or something, but I mean, he's zipping all over the place. Like, you have that scene, and then all of a sudden he's back at his apartment in New York with his friend, and they're talking over what's been going on at the museum. And here he learns that there was this rumor anyway, that the Gainsborough that was destroyed was not really the Gainsborough. And that's what has the director of the museum in such a tizzy.
Another misdirection that worked on me, because I was not familiar with the actress, Mary Ware, who plays the secretary Mary.
Oh yeah, she's such a sweet, helpful young girl. And yeah, turns out she's the evil mall. Ray Collins.
That's a very familiar trope at this point. But the actor, because I wasn't familiar with the actress, I just thought it worked on me because I just thought this is a weird actress. She's so mousy, so extraordinarily mousy. What a weird casting decision to put any actress like this in any movie.
Yeah, I know. I don't know who she is at all, Mary Ware. I liked her a lot in this movie, and she's playing a character named Mary. It's maybe the only movie she ever made, for all we know.
Yeah, but it absolutely worked to throw me off the scent. And him too.
Nicely commenting on, you know, why would this secretary at the museum do all these things to help him if she wasn't
just so fucking nice?
Yeah, but in fact, no. The only reason she's doing it is because she is playing her own game at the behest of Ray Collins to, you know, push Pat O'Brien into doing what they want him to do. Everyone is moving Pat O'Brien around like a pawn.
And he has no ally other than Claire Trevor, and she herself is also under suspicion.
Yeah, it's great. Great movie. Pat O'Brien is in jeopardy so many times in this movie. In danger of going insane. He's in danger of suffocating to death when he gets trapped in the cargo hold with the burning painting. Again, Herbert Marshall is just lurking around the corner all the time. He has to explain to people that ask him at several points. Yeah, I could have stopped him, but no, I want to see what happens next.
Right, and then there's, of course, Peep Show sequence. That was an interesting setting.
Yeah, well, that whole arcade scene was great.
And Pat O'Brien does get to show that he may be a schlubby middle-aged man, but he can throw a punch. He can get violent.
He can put some bulk behind that punch.
Punch behind the punch.
Yeah, the cop who seems to be eyeing Claire Trevor and Pat O'Brien, but in fact he thinks there's a child looking at some porn.
That was a pretty good exchange.
Yeah. How old are you, bub?
How old are you? I'm 39. How old are you?
And Claire Trevor gets to do a little imitation of a Brooklynese secretary. It was pretty fun. I mean,
we've seen her be very evil.
Yeah,
And we will see her be very evil again. Here she's very good.
Yeah, it's a nice change of pace for her.
She's good at it.
Yeah.
Definitely. I will be looking forward to seeing her and Lawrence Tierney together in Born to Kill. You say we're doing that on our next...
RKO 1947 is going to be amazing because it's going to be Born to Kill and Out of the Past. So two all-time film noir classics.
Great.
Next week on the podcast, however, we've got a quartet of 1940s Sam Goldwyn films.
Yeah, if you think you don't have quite enough content this week, just wait, because not only that, but we are also starting a new retrospective at TIFF.
The Powell Pressburger movies, and we have managed to get tickets for almost everything, and we anticipate...
So you're looking at like 2 hours next week.
Probably, at least, yeah. So we're going to be talking about The Little Foxes, The Pride of the Yankees, The Best Years of Our Lives, and My Foolish Heart. So set aside a lot of viewing time if you are watching along with us, because that's going to be about 10 hours worth of movies to watch. But I'm really looking forward to it. I loved our 1930s Goldwyn movies, and these are, if anything, even better. So
that's going to be quite a week coming up.